Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everybody, and welcome to today's SIS webinar. I want to thank you for taking the time out of your schedule to join us here today. My name is Kim Parisi, and I am Director, Global Events here at SIG. I have the pleasure of facilitating today's webinar entitled The Categorical Imperative, Advancing Strategic Partnerships Through a Category Management Framework, presented to us today by GEP. Now, today's webinar is intended to be interactive, so please submit your questions throughout the presentation by typing them in the Q&A box. You can find that in the lower right-hand side of your screen, and we will do our best to answer all of your questions at the end of the presentation. We will also be sharing the slides with you, and we will push them out at the conclusion of the webinar. And in addition to receiving them via email today, the presentation can also be accessed through the GEP website on demand. You can go to GEP.com and look at their Knowledge Bank section, and you can find that within the next couple of days. Now, to kick things off, I would like to go through just a few SIG reminders. And the first one is in regards to global events. Of course, SIG holds events all over the world, and I hope you can join us for at least one of our signature events or share them with your colleagues. Please check the SIG website frequently for upcoming cities and current agendas. And of course, we hold weekly webinars. You can visit our website for a complete listing of all upcoming webinars, and you can register for them today. They all require unique registration, so take a look at what's coming up and go ahead and get yourself registered early. Our peer-to-peer resource is an opportunity to ask top-of-mind questions for instant responses. Those inquiries go out on Tuesday and Wednesday, and you do not have to be a SIG member to respond, so please help us out by chiming in when you see those hit your inbox. And our SIG Resource Center has been completely revamped. We've worked hard on this in the year 2017. It is home to over 5,000 tools, templates, white papers, presentations, and many, many research documents, all intended to help make your job easier each and every day. Our SIG website also offers a career network where we post jobs for sourcing professionals and internship opportunities for all levels of employment. And of course, our Student Talent Outreach Program. This was designed to find tomorrow's supply chain professionals today. All while students are still honing their skills and learning about the industry, we can connect you with them to have further conversation about how they can fit into your companies. So please reach out to me directly or anybody on the SIG team for more information on any of these events. And that brings me to our Global Executive Summit. As you know, we hold semi-annual summits. These bring together more than 350 decision-making delegates. The entire summit agenda and event details are available online. Registration is open. And our fall summit is coming up in beautiful Carlsbad, California, October 9 through 12. If you have not registered, it is not too late. Please do so. And our room block is still available. So if you have not booked your room, please access the SIG website and click on the hotel link that will take you to their private portal to securely book a room. That room block will be expiring in the next week or so. So please do that before the expiration date. I believe it's September 25th. Moving on to global events. As SIG gains more of a global footprint, please take a look at some of the upcoming global events on the SIG website under networking events. If you have colleagues in any of these cities, please feel free to share this information with them as well. And SIG University, this is where we're offering training and development opportunities to people of all levels in their sourcing careers. Registration is open, so please visit siguniversity.org for all of the details. We've also launched an individual membership program, and as an individual member, you maintain your SIG membership no matter where your career takes you, company to company, position to position. Your membership still allows you to access things like the SIG Resource Center or attending networking events. You can find out more at sig.org/membership. And that brings me to today's webinar brought to us by GEP. And the title of the presentation is The Categorical Imperative, Advancing Strategic Partnerships Through a Category Management Framework. I want to extend a warm welcome to our presenter, Biju Mohan. Biju is the Vice President of Consulting at GEP, based in GEP's Clark, New Jersey headquarters, where he has led several large-scale strategic sourcing programs, His over 18 years of management consulting experience, having worked with clients across industries located in the United States, Europe, and Asia. During this time, he has led and managed large projects for several organizations in the consumer goods and retail sector. He has recently selected as one of the pros to know by Supply and Demand Chain Executive. Prior to joining GEP, Mohan was a senior manager in the strategy consulting practice at H.E. Kearney, responsible for managing several large-scale engagements with multiple clients in India. Previously, he was a manager with Accenture's Consulting Group. Mohan holds an MBA from the Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta, and a BS in Computer Science from the Indian Institute of Technology in Mumbai. And with that, I want to welcome you to today's presentation and give you the floor. Biju, thank you.
Thank you, Kim. Thanks for that introduction. Welcome to everyone. A good morning, afternoon, or evening, depending on where you are signing in from. Thanks a lot for being a part of this webinar on category management, and I look forward to sharing my experience in this space with you today. Before we start, I wanted to give a bit of an overview about GEP itself. So I wanted to start off by providing an overview of what our capabilities are. GEP is a global organization focused on supply chain and procurement solutions. We have about 14 offices and delivery centers located all over the world. And through these locations, we serve more than 200 global clients spread out across more than 20 industries. In terms of our spend, we manage about $75 billion of spend across multiple categories in the direct and indirect space. And what do we do for them? We do multiple things. We work on category strategies. We look at procurement transformation. We look at procurement execution, driving efficiencies and savings, and also supporting them through a suite of technology tools. In short, we are a comprehensive one-stop shop for all procurement-related services and solutions for global companies. Giving a bit more color to it, as I mentioned, we have presence in consulting services, we have experience and support, expertise in the managed services, and we also have our own internal in-house technology solutions supporting the procurement area. As a combination of these, we are able to provide to clients faster time to value, increased visibility of their spend, and also providing them the control to manage the spend effectively and efficiently, providing them strategies and helping them execute to reduce their overall operating costs, either through category strategies or through managed services to reduce the overall cost of procurement operations itself. We also support our clients in improving compliance by monitoring the results and effectiveness of the implementation of the strategies and helping them address any issues in risk and management in terms of supporting the implementation in a much more effective way. Finally, we pride ourselves on our customer service, and we also look at customer first when we look at all our services across consulting and technology. In terms of today's webinar content, we wanted to cover four specific areas from category management perspective. We wanted to start off by agreeing on the definition that we use for category management and where does category strategy fit in with regard to that, and what are the key value drivers that drive the category management activities globally in terms of organizations. I wanted to touch upon a bit on the market trends that we are observing there in the way companies are approaching category management and what are some of the key themes that are coming out based on our understanding of the market changes. Finally, we wanted to talk about some of the common challenges that companies will face or are already facing when they move into a global or a regional category management approach, and what in our experience has worked for them to manage or mitigate these risks, and what are some of the strategies that can be put in place. I wanted to leave at the end with some real life examples of how a successful category management strategy that has been implemented resulted and helped companies not only drive down costs but also helped improve the overall services, the service levels that were provided to businesses. So starting with the definition of category management, we wanted to focus on two essential elements from a category management perspective. So category management in our definition is the intermediate stage which provides the connectivity between the organizational objective and the external market dynamics. In other words, what we do is we understand the business strategy, we understand the business desired outcomes, use that and combine the expectation of what the market supply market changes are going through, figure out what's the best way to manage a specific category, which will help the company achieve the desired outcome. Some of the things that we need to consider as part of this is, what is the business strategy? What are the top line growth objectives? How are they? How are the businesses planning their strategy and the way their organization is going to be changing over the next 3 to 5 years? And what are the kind of imperatives that they have? Will they be cost focused? Will they be service level focused? Will they be innovation focused? Or will it be a combination of all the above? In alignment with that, we consider the supply market side of it. Look at what the other companies are doing. What are the supply market changes that are going through? What are the technology and the innovations that are happening in the market? And what's the market itself going through? Are they going through a period of consolidation? Is there more global suppliers, or is the suppliers now being more focusing on regional areas? Marrying the two will be the critical part of developing an effective category management strategy. And each category will have different impact on different areas of the business objectives, and that's some important factor that we need to consider while developing this category strategy. Category management is not a one-time activity. It's in fact a cyclical process. It's an end-to-end activity which just does not end at the definition of a category strategy. The first step, as I mentioned earlier, is understanding the internal and external situation. Internal from a business perspective, what are the various objectives of the businesses that are touched upon by different categories? In the case of direct categories, it's fairly straightforward, but the complexity in my experience is also observed primarily in the indirect categories. Indirect categories touch upon multiple functions at a point of time. To give you an example, certain areas of print, for example, or print production, is influenced not only by marketing, but also influenced by the globalization, the extent of global impact that the business needs to drive, the IT impact, what's the kind of technology that exists within the organization today, what's the plan for technology going forward, and finally, in terms of operations, who is going to do it? Is it going to be done internally, or is it going to be done externally? All these decisions together need to be considered when you're developing a strategy for marketing print. So as I mentioned, one of the important steps is to define what is the kind of impact from an internal perspective and external perspective while defining what is the category strategy to be defined. The second step is, using these insights, both from an internal and external perspective, understand what are the major objectives that the business is trying to achieve. As I mentioned, if the focus is on cost, the category strategy would be different here, vis-a-vis if the focus is going to be on innovation. Using those as the primary objectives and figuring out what are the business objectives that needs to be achieved, a category strategy needs to be defined. Once the strategy is developed and defined and agreed with, the next step is in the execution phase. The critical part that procurement is always been focused on traditionally is in terms of the sourcing implementation. But here, in terms of category management perspective, the breadth of that scope increases. It does not just end at getting the right suppliers in place, but it now extends into ensuring that the suppliers are delivering what is required, the business is meeting its objectives, and the strategy is executing as per the original plan. One of the important things that will also need to be done is based on continuous feedback that is obtained not only from the business, but also from the external partners. Procurement will need to drive course corrections or changes in the strategy as is needed, as is observed. A few things that we need to keep in mind while looking at category management. One is that it's not a one-off activity. It's going to be an ongoing cyclical process that will be a day-to-day activity. Second, category strategy is not the responsibility of procurement alone. While procurement will drive category strategy development, there will be a comprehensive involvement of the other functions, specifically the businesses that are going to be impacted by some of these category strategies. Also, we need to keep in mind that support functions like HR, IT, and finance will need to be involved at the necessary stage to ensure that the category strategy is holistic and factors in all the necessary implications that the organization will have by executing it. Finally, in terms of the execution focus, the procurement function will need to keep in mind that it's not just important to roll out the strategy, but it is also important to track effective versus realized benefits achieved through that strategy. What were the planned savings, or what is the planned impact, and has that been realized? That's a critical question that category management activity category managers will need to focus on an ongoing basis as we proceed. With that, with the definition of category management and the value drivers being clear, let's look at some of the key market trends and some of the key themes that you're observing. Traditionally, the focus of procurement has been in terms of rate negotiations and looking at contracting and supply contracts. That has been driving a significant portion of the savings or the results that have been one of the KPIs for procurement functions in most companies. However, what's also now coming across is that it's not just the only lever that procurement has to drive benefits to the organization. There are other levers that are such as demand management, operating efficiencies, changes in specifications, looking at faster and more flexible way of supporting businesses. All these are typically levers that are addressed through a specific or a structured category management process. As you can see, based on a recent survey that we did, we looked at the kind of savings that are achieved by organizations and what are the levers or the sources of these savings. While still the strategic sourcing and spend reduction drives almost half of the total savings that are achieved, there is still a significant portion of savings that are now coming through category management. This is especially true for organizations where procurement is already fairly mature. So spend reduction and strategic sourcing already have extracted the low-hanging fruit, so to say. So the next wave of savings are typically going to be driven through category management. And when I say category management, I'm talking about more effective category strategies, which impact not only the rate or the service contracts of the suppliers, but specifically the demand side of it, as well as the way the services or products are supplied by the external partners to the organization. In addition to these, there are other opportunities that are also leveraged by organizations to drive savings through category management. The first is in terms of a better visibility on some of the results that are achieved through implementation of category management. One of the big gaps that we have observed in organizations that are struggling to drive savings through category management is a lack of visibility. A lack of visibility not only in terms of the spend or the distribution across suppliers or the regions, but also in terms of the realization of savings. How many of the savings or impacts that have been provided as part of procurement strategies have been realized? What's the impact of compliance? What's the level of compliance? What are the reasons for that non-compliance? How can that be fixed? Bringing that visibility is one of the key aspects that needs to be the focus of category management. The second is looking at a comprehensive way to reduce the operating costs through further process improvement. This could be through technology, this could be through leveraging activities like use of external partners to outsource certain activities, and looking at ways to leverage suppliers to focus on areas where they are more competitive and thereby reduce the total cost to the organization itself. One of the key aspects that I also would like to highlight here is in terms of the trend that we're seeing in the market of utilization of external experts for various aspects. In general, what we have seen is that category management can be classified into broadly two areas. There are certain areas which are internally driven, which includes category strategy development. Second area in terms of execution and monitoring the compliance is some things that are typically tactical in nature, and we have seen an increasing incidence of them being outsourced to external parties. Again, the level of outsourcing, the level of involvement of external agencies varies from category to category, as you can see here. In a recent survey done by Everest, what we have seen is that typically facilities and operations are the ones where there is a higher level of involvement of external parties to drive category management activities. Typically, the factors which impact this are the category value, the nature of the category itself, and how critical or how important is it to the core operations. Finally, it's also a decision that the organization takes in terms of what's the level of involvement that they would like to maintain for this on this kind of a category. As you can see, there is a lot of specific factors which drive the decisions on whether a category needs to be internally managed or to be managed externally. Typically, again, in our example, as you can see, this is a very category or industry-driven approach. There are certain industries like pharma where facilities and operations might be more critical or core and would need to be maintained internally. Whereas certain areas like retail or manufacturing, where facilities and operations would be less core, and there are more critical activities where they would want their internal procurement people to focus on, and where they would typically tend to outsource it. Moving on to the next part. So typically, I wanted to spend a little bit of time on terms of what are the typical challenges that are faced by organizations when they go ahead and implement a very strong category management process. A snapshot of some of the typical challenges that we have observed in our experience. The first is in terms of the nature of the category itself. Categories, especially in the indirect space, are very different and very diverse in their nature, not only in terms of the nature of the category itself, but also in the nature of the spend. There are categories which are fairly regional in nature, such as logistics or transportation, or even capital, where the spend are very locally or regionally driven, with budgets being developed at the site level in some cases, and being managed at a very local level. However, there are also categories which are much more global in nature, IT, for example. Many of the organizations that we deal with today have a global IT spend and is managed at a very global level. This is also influenced by the nature of the supply markets. There are global suppliers who can provide some similar levels of services and products at a global level, whereas there are certain categories where the approach is much more regional or even very local in nature. Accordingly, the nature of spend will dictate the way these categories are managed. The key challenges in such situations are the nature of the implementation and how do we carry along multiple regions, especially for categories which are regionally managed. The typical approach to addressing that is by establishing a very robust governance framework. The focus of this governance framework will be not only to look at the progress of the various activities that are developed or defined as an outcome of the category strategy. These activities would be at a regional level as well as at a global level. The intent of the governance team would be to ensure that the regional teams are executing the regional activities and also they are aligned with the overall global strategy. In addition, one of the important things that we observe is not to be too rigid about the strategy execution. Make sure that we are focusing on course corrections as we get more and more inputs when we are in the implementation phase. The second part of the spend profile management at a regional level is to look at centralization of certain processes. There are certain activities like sourcing strategies or global category strategy developments that it still makes sense to be done at a global level, but executing those and measuring compliance would be something which could potentially be done at a regional level. So deciding what level of processes to be managed at global and what level would be done at the regional level would be a critical part of managing the risk associated with this area. The second challenge that we have observed is a big one, is the change management. Any change in the category management processes is usually met with some resistance, especially in the regions or in the functions which are used to getting work done in a specific way. It's never to be underestimated, because underestimating it will result in an improper execution, or even if the execution is done properly, the adoption of that will be severely limited, which can impact the realization of the benefits that were proposed as part of the strategy. A comprehensive change management program needs to be implemented as part of this, with clearly defined responsibilities and accountabilities outlined for each function, not only at the global level, but also at the regional level. Providing clarity to the regions and to the functions in terms of what are the ways of working, what has changed, what's in it for them, and what is going to be the key accountable people who are going to be part of this rollout will be very critical. Typically, this is done in a top-down way with a lot of support from the senior management. So any change that we are proposing on a category management structure at a global level needs to be endorsed by the top management and needs to be communicated not only at multiple levels, but also very frequently. Let's not treat it as a checklist kind of an approach, but let's treat it as an approach which is an ongoing process which will have to be done continuously and with a feedback mechanism, so that we can get the inputs from the impacted functions and the regions, so that we can factor that into our communication and the category strategies. The second thing to consider while looking at a comprehensive category management implementation is a phased approach. Again, there are certain regions or there are certain categories which are probably more mature within an organization and which are more open to change. factoring those in and then using that as a wave one of categories for implementation can have a big impact. These can be used as success stories, which can then be used for publicity for the remaining categories. This can also be used for managing the change in an effective way by using that as a demonstration of the benefits of the new structure of category management for those categories. The third big gap that we have observed is in terms of the communication that needs to be managed between the functions, between procurement and the business, and even within procurement across the globe and multiple regions. A lack of communication, most in terms of clarity and frequency, can have a severe impact on the outcome of various category strategies. This is also compounded if there is no clarity on the responsibilities as to who are responsible and who is accountable for each activity in the category management. One of the critical things that we need to do as part of the change is to establish adequate communication protocols, define service level agreements between businesses, between functions and procurement, making sure that procurement understands what are the kind of service level changes that they are adopting, making sure that the business understands that this is the responsibility of procurement, this is the responsibility of the business. So distribution of the responsibilities is going to be one of the very critical activities that needs to be communicated very clearly. Finally, we also need to make sure that as part of our communication that the stakeholders who are not only impacted but who are also participating in this process from procurement as well as business are very clear about who is responsible for what. Having that clarity will ensure that there is an appropriate escalation mechanism in place, appropriate governance mechanism in place, so that corrective action can be taken as needed during the course of the category management implementation. Finally, strategy is usually done on paper, but execution translates into a lot of real life issues that come up during the implementation. Never be rigid, as I mentioned earlier. Be ready to understand what are some of the changes that will need to be done as we go through the implementation process. How do we do that? We leverage analytical tools to get information and spend and use that as an insight to build insights into what are some of the changes required. The second part is to provide that transparency in terms of the data and the results and the metrics to all the necessary stakeholders. Once there is clarity in terms of what are the outcomes, what is the progress towards the outcomes, and what are some of the clear data-driven impacts that we are observing, that also helps drive behavior, drives change. So providing that necessary analytical tools and the information to these relevant stakeholders at the right point of time very frequently helps in improving the transparency and helps in driving the change regarding this. I wanted to spend a little bit of time elaborating a bit on the category strategy approach, and because that's one of the most critical parts of the category management. As I explained earlier, category strategy is the a linkage between the business strategy and how it will translate into an external party related services or a product that will be providing the business the necessary area. Category strategy, from a first point of view, needs to get inputs from the business strategy, but it is also very common for category strategy to provide inputs as the business strategy is being finalized. One of the critical things that we can see from here is a role that procurement can play by being that conduit for not only getting the inputs on business outcomes that are required, but also influencing those business outcomes based on procurement's understanding of the market conditions. There is the second part we need to look at is in terms of the implications that the procurement function will need to look at based on a defined category strategy. What are the kind of changes that is expected from a business outcome perspective? How can suppliers or external partners provide that service? Should it be done by external partners or should it be done internally? These are some of the questions that the procurement function will need to answer as they're finalizing a category strategy for this. In addition, what we also need to remember is that category strategy is never to be developed in isolation by procurement. It's a joint activity. There are inputs that will be required from business side in terms of the strategy and their operating requirements, which needs to be addressed. There are inputs needed from support functions like finance and HR and IT, especially in areas where the ways of working is going to change substantially. And finally, procurement will need to solicit support from some of the key external partners who have been strategic in nature, who have been supporting the organization, and who also have an external point of view. Consolidating all of this together will define the category strategy. Finally, once the category strategy is set up, that will translate into defining the necessary sourcing initiatives that needs to be put in place to execute that category strategy. This is the area where there is a lot of involvement of the procurement function in translating that specific categories into multiple supply related activities, which will further translate into sourcing strategies for each of the sub areas. Once those sourcing initiatives are executed, once those sourcing strategies are implemented, the next step is to translate that into supplier selection. Selecting the right partner at the right for the right kind of area with the right objectives in mind is one of the critical parts in terms of implementation of the sourcing strategy. Again, this is a multifunctional activity. Sourcing drives this process, procurement drives this activity, but at the same time, there needs to be inputs from the other functions which are going to be influenced or which are going to be impacted by the decision regarding the supplier selection. Final accountability of the supplier selection usually remains with procurement. But the decision in terms of the final partner that needs to be selected is usually done with the impacted function. Once the supplies are put in place, the next step is to put in place a process of a comprehensive category execution plan, where the preferred suppliers, the communication regarding the preferred suppliers and the necessary outcomes are communicated to the organization. Then the regular work starts in terms of monitoring the compliance, understanding what are the reasons for non-compliance, what can be done to manage these non-compliance, what kind of change management needs to be put in place. Is there a non-compliance related activity which is driven by suppliers? Does that need to address, go back and be readdressed in the category strategy? These are some of the questions that need to be answered at that phase by the procurement folks. A bit more, a deeper dive into the category strategy development process here. So the first step, as I explained earlier, is to understand the current market conditions and the processes that are planned by the business. Now, one of the critical parts here that we have observed is that functions in many cases do not have a very clearly defined outcome planned yet. They do expect, this is an outcome that is fairly highly for lack of a better word, vaguely defined whenever the process starts for defining a category strategy. It's in this activity where procurement can work with the business to detail out the necessary objectives, to identify what are the key levers that needs to be addressed. Is it cost? Is it innovation? Is it service? If so, how are they prioritized? In many cases, these are questions that need not always be an either-or question, but could be a combination also. So addressing these questions will play a big role in understanding how the category will be, what is the category strategy that needs to be put in place to solve the requirement that the business is looking for. In parallel, as I said, the procurement function will also need to look at what are the kind of market trends that exist today. What's the general activities that are seen? What are the kind of technological innovations that are seeing? Secondly, what's the kind of supply market changes that we are observing there? Is the supply market consolidating? Are there global players coming into picture? Or are there still regional players in place? And how can this impact the way the service or the product needs to be delivered to the business to meet their outcomes? Combining these two will help us understand the best approach that needs to be provided to help achieve the business outcomes. Once that is done, procurement function will come up with a multiple set of options that can help define in terms of what are the kind of actions or options that are available for procurement and the function to achieve these outcomes. Once that is done, typically there is a whole value proposition that needs to be defined. Now, these value proposition can be different for different functions for the same category. In the case of the business, the focus could be on service levels, or the focus could be on achieving revenue targets. For procurement, the focus could be on having the right partner in place to provide the necessary outcomes. For finance, it could be cost or working capital. Having all these value propositions clear and articulating them and how they are being addressed by the category strategy is going to be very critical. Once that is done, the next step is to obviously look at how that will be implemented. This will translate into the sourcing strategy, the sourcing plan, and the prioritization of that plan. Whether it will be rolled out globally, whether it will be done at a regional level, that will also be part of the decision that needs to be done by procurement. Will it be done in a phased manner? Will it be done in a big bang plan? That's also the third aspect that will need to be considered. Once these parameters are defined, the next step is to understand what are the key activities, who will be responsible for them, who will be accountable for them, and what is the kind of governance mechanism that will be driven by procurement to drive the execution of this. That's going to be a critical part, as I explained earlier, and that's always one of the big challenges in driving change at a large scale, at a global scale for many category management activities. So a program management approach to drive these initiatives and ensuring that things are going on time and the necessary actions are being escalated with the necessary support of top management will be critical from a success factor perspective. What we wanted to do next was share a few examples of some of the work that was done by GEP with a few global clients in terms of implementing a successful category strategy. I have three examples which I wanted to share in detail with you, which will give you a perspective of the different outcomes that were achieved for each of those through a successful category strategy. I wanted to start off with an example for capital projects. So this is a company which has a global footprint. There is a significant spend on capital as part of their overall growth strategy. However, the capital project spend itself was classified into multiple areas. There were the high impact capital projects, which were high spend, which were impacting the manufacturing process, and which are critical from either a quality perspective or a market facing activity perspective. However, there were also a significant number of low impact capital projects. Individually, they were very small spend, but collectively, they formed a substantial portion of the total spend. They formed between 15 to 20% of the total spend and therefore was substantial enough. However, what we observed was that because of the nature of these capital projects, because they were very local and they were low spend individually, there was limited focus on this. So as a result, there was a lot of money that was left on the table because the whole process of setting up the right capital partner was not done in a proper way. Secondly, many of these projects, being low budget and low spend, were driven very locally. As a result, there was very limited oversight in terms of what's the kind of oversight at the local level. Thirdly, many of these activities were done without the involvement of procurement. Procurement was not involved at all in the decision regarding selection of the right partner, the contractual terms and conditions, and in terms of the managing the supplies on a regular basis. An outcome of all this was that there was significant money that was being spent without an understanding of the level of detail at a local level for these kind of projects. So one of the things that was done as part of this was to develop a category strategy for small impact capital projects. The first step was to collect the data of planned capital projects spent across regions, across sites for the next 1 year. This was a comprehensive task where the procurement function worked with the local engineering teams and the local facilities to get the details about the budgeted plan, as well as the details in terms of what's the kind of spend that is expected for this, or what's the nature of the budget that is expected for this. The second step was to consolidate all this and classify it into three broad areas. There were certain set of projects within the small impact capital projects that needed to be done through in-house expertise. They had to be managed with the support from the appropriate contractor, construction management companies or contractors, and had to be managed at a procurement level or at a local level to drive those projects to completion. The second group of projects were more of a hybrid set of projects, which could be potentially outsourced, but also could be managed in-house depending upon the nature of the spend and the nature of the requirement that the organization had. And the last group of activities, or last group of capital projects, were very clearly could have been outsourced to an external agency and entrusted with them as a turnkey kind of a structure, where they are responsible for the end-to-end delivery of that work. That was the first step in terms of classification of the project. The second step was to understand and develop a very clear decision tree depending upon the outcomes. There were certain projects that were driven by timeline considerations, whereas there were certain projects that were driven by cost considerations. The focus here, therefore, was to have a very easy to use, clear, transparent way of deciding when to use which kind of service providers. Should we do it in-house, or should we do it externally through an agency, or should we do it through a preferred construction management provider? Setting up that decision tree along with the agreement of the engineering teams in the sites was the second big activity as part of the category management strategy. The third part was to select the preferred partner for the activities which are going to be managed externally. A comprehensive sourcing strategy needed to be put in place as an outcome of this, which translated into clearly defined SLAs, clearly defined risk management activities, clearly defined compliance objectives that were classified and developed based on a combination of inputs from finance, from local engineering teams, as well as global engineering teams. As a result, the outcome of all this was to have a portfolio of projects with clearly defined approaches as defined in the category strategy, and clearly defined preferred partners for multiple types of activities that will be done globally. What are some of the outcomes of implementing this and rolling it out on a global basis? First, in terms of execution, because we had a pool of pre-qualified suppliers, it was very easy to look at to select the appropriate supplier. The resource requisitions became much faster, and the site were able to execute their project in a much more faster way. The time earlier spent in supplier identification, supplier selection, etc., was cut short significantly. Finally, it also helped them get a better estimate of the design and cost, which were missing earlier in many of these smaller projects. They used to be taking approximations, but now, thanks to the availability of pre-qualified suppliers who were aware of the local conditions, they were able to get much stronger estimates in terms of what is the cost structure. The second part was in terms of the service levels. What was done was to establish a very clearly defined set of contracts with the preferred partners, with clearly defined service levels that have put in place to ensure that the business outcomes are being met for those respective cases. If cost within budget was the critical parameter, that used to be the criteria defined for that specific piece of work. If timeline was the biggest consideration, that used to be it. So at a project-to-project basis, the service level flexibility was ensured through structuring the contract in the appropriate. The third part was mitigating the risks and audit compliance. One of the things that was put in place was an effective governance mechanism by procurement to not only monitor the results, but also to monitor the way the service is being offered by the agencies and the construction management companies to support the organization at the sites in establishing or implementing these projects. Finally, last but not the least, there were clear cost savings. What was clearly done as an outcome of this was that 10 to 15% of the budget reduction was due to the implementation of a set of preferred suppliers, better robust control of processes, and focused compliance monitoring across all locations for the smaller capital projects. In addition, this team also helped achieve corporate goals through driving these in terms of small and diversity businesses, as well as looking at an implementation of a global set of discounted payment terms that helped achieve a corporate set of objectives. A slightly different example, but in a related area, was an implementation of a furniture strategy for a different company. Again, and as in the previous case, the organization was going through a comprehensive growth process, as part of which they had completely revamped or refurnished their entire locations globally. There was a comprehensive process where the office facilities and the site facilities were being restructured, which translated into a significant planned spend on furniture solutions across their plant operations as well as their corporate offices. However, this was being done in a very decentralized way. Each location would take decisions independently, would select their own suppliers, would set up their own timelines with very limited oversight in terms of what's the kind of desired outcomes and what is the kind of supplies to be put in place. In addition, because of the lack of procurement involvement, there was no central monitoring authority who could manage such kind of relationships with the suppliers. This resulted in different guarantees, different warranty terms, different pricing structures, and very often this also resulted in a lot of dissatisfaction with the local providers who were providing these furniture solutions to the sites. So the category strategy in this case was to look at a comprehensive global approach, consolidated approach, driven by procurement to drive the space. The first thing that was done was to understand what is the rollout plan for usage of furniture in the locations on a competency year-by-year basis. Based on that, it was possible to look at what are the kind of requirements at a regional level, at a local level, and what are the timelines of expectations. Using this, it was decided that there is an opportunity for implementing a global preferred partnership with a global furniture solutions provider. Based on our clarity of data and based on the data that was shared with them, it was possible for them to come back and commit to the time and cost structure that they would be most comfortable with for the planned rollout across all the locations. The first outcome of that, looking at a comprehensive way and consolidating the business with one supplier, was a significant reduction in the planned spend. It was almost a 35% reduction in the expected cost of outlay on furniture spend across all the regions put together. Secondly, thanks to the larger business that was now centralized and concentrated with one supplier, it also helped in driving lower total cost of ownership. It not only fixed the prices for a longer period of time, but also helped establish much stronger warranty conditions across multiple years for the supplier. Third, thanks to a comprehensive structured contract that was put in place with a global partner, and since the partner was one partner across all the regions, managing the supplier was much more easier. This helped in them executing it much more rapidly and helped the procurement function in making sure that it's able to monitor the performance of the supplier in a much more easier way, much more comprehensive way, with inputs from the local sites. Over and all, it was a win-win situation for both the suppliers as well as for the facilities, the local facilities, who now saw a better cost structure, better warranties, more responsive suppliers, and ability to meet all their aggressive timelines. Another example of a good category strategy that was put in place with support from the necessary functions. The last example I would like to give is in a different space altogether. It's in the space of marketing. This is the third company, which is a CPG company, which had been looking at a multiple set of opportunities in terms of reducing their cost on branded items and premiums that were being purchased at their facilities. This specific trend, to give you a bit of a context, was distributed across 16 countries, especially in the APAC and LATAM regions. Traditionally, this spend was very decent sliced. Spend was being managed by different sites, and almost there was no involvement of procurement. Whenever there was any requirement for any specific branded item or premium to be purchased, the local stakeholder who was involved in that decision would make their own decision in terms of who are the best partners and make that purchase. What happened was that there were more than 100 individual sourcing events, which each of them different, with limited compliance overall and very limited control in terms of the nature of the spend. Similarly, although the kind of products and materials that were being purchased across regions were fairly similar, these synergies were not being exploited in an effective way by the organization. Third, there was a substantial duplication of efforts. Each of the stakeholders who were involved in the purchasing process, because of the lack of procurement involvement, would spend a lot of time in identifying the supplier, negotiating the pricing, and then executing them on a day-to-day basis. Finally, thanks to the multiple suppliers and multiple stakeholders involved in the process, the branding process that was related to the branded items was very inconsistent, and that had a big impact from a marketing perspective. So, as a result of this, there was an opportunity for us to look at a category strategy to address this specific category. In addition, one of the business outcomes that the organization was looking at was a more comprehensive, standardized branding message to the organization, which has helped them provide a consistent message to the customers. Together, based on the desired outcome of a consistent branding message globally, procurement decided to work with the marketing function to see how this can be centralized and more done in a more consolidated manner. The first step was to look at suppliers who have capabilities from a delivery perspective and ability perspective in both these geographies. Second step was to look at how technology can be leveraged to provide support in this area. Many of the suppliers that they selected or identified to participate in the process came up with several inputs or insights into how this can be done effectively through a consolidated centralized hub-based approach with a catalog solution. The catalog solution provides an interface to many of the stakeholders who can just go to this catalog structure, select what they want, and place their irrespective of where they are located, whether they are located in Asia or whether they are located in LATAM. Providing that unique interface helped standardize the ordering process and also helped drive compliance in a much better way. Secondly, having one preferred supplier or a couple of preferred suppliers to support this process helped in making sure that we are leveraging the scale economies and ensuring that the organization is getting the best value for money for each of these prices. Third, finally, there was increased compliance and also provided much more reduced timeline in terms of monitoring these processes and managing the activities with regard to functional involvement. Finally, last but not the least, the overall workflow process was easy to understand, easy to use by the users, and therefore would result in a much more streamlined activity of ordering process. One of the observations when we looked at the earlier context was that there were many ordering that was done individually, which resulted in a lot of leftover stock, and which were basically money left on the table for the organization. Thanks to this ordered process of using catalogs, it reduced inventory of branded item stock, and that and therefore reduced the wastage of material. Finally, having one supplier helped in managing the communication between marketing and that supplier from a branding perspective, and also helped establish a consistent branding message to the customers across Asia and LATAM. This whole model was also supported through an integrated service process where we leveraged technology and looked at consolidation of suppliers and using catalog process to streamline the activities. So this is an example of a category strategy which not just focused on looking at suppliers, but also looked at how technology and the services can be consolidated to provide the necessary impact to the customers. In this case, we also help marketing achieve their overall objective of providing a consistent branding message to the markets, irrespective of the geographies. And that was done through a single unified supplier and a single unified approach for ordering the material. That brings me towards the end of this webinar in terms of the examples that I wanted to share. I will now let Kim monitor some of the questions that probably have come up as you have been listening to the webinar, and I can answer those questions.
That's great, Biju. Thank you so much. But there was so much information in there, and we did get a few questions coming in. The first one reads, what are the key skill sets, in your opinion, that are required to be a successful category manager? And what can the category manager do on an ongoing basis to ensure stakeholders remain engaged in the strategy and plan?
Thank you, Kim. One of the key aspects from a category management success perspective is to have an understanding of both the business side and the supply side. Procurement is in a unique role with regard to playing a critical part of combining or providing that connecting link between getting the business outcome understood and providing the necessary external partnership to support that business outcome. So one of the key success factors that is required is a good understanding of the business or the functions that are being impacted by the category. So category managers who are managing categories in the marketing function needs to have a good understanding of the marketing requirements. What are the changes? What are the marketing strategy of the organization to which they belong? And how is that going to be impacted by the categories that they are going to be supporting? Similarly, they need to have a good external view, having a good understanding of the supply market conditions, the technology and the innovations that are happening, and tapping into the right suppliers to provide that insight will be very critical. That's the second aspect that we need to remember. The third big change, or the third big success factor that we need to keep in mind is for the category managers are very often in the middle of many of these change that needs to be implemented. So they need to be effective change agents. So it's important for them to be able to work with multiple functions, multiple stakeholders within functions as well as across regions and carry them along in terms of the strategy implementation. So they need to be good communicators, able to articulate the messages in a very effective way. solicit the support of the necessary levels of management to drive those changes, and also to be able to understand what are the what kind of course corrections are needed while implementing the strategy to make sure that it is effective. So I would say, in short, a good understanding of the business, good understanding of the external market, and being very good change agents. These are the key success factors.
Excellent explanation. Thank you so much for that. Moving on to the next question, which reads, how do you decide which categories to be centralized or decentralized? Or how do you decide which are centralized or decentralized?
Thanks, Kim. That's a great question, actually. So there are multiple factors that are impacting a category which would be managed centrally or which would probably be done more regionally. The biggest factor would be the nature of the spend itself in the organization. So if it's a spend that is fairly well distributed across regions and whether it is distributed across functions, that would be something that we'll have to factor in as one of the important areas to consider. The second aspect is the supply market itself. Does this category have global suppliers, other global partners who are available to service the multiple geographies and multiple functions for the organization? That would be the second aspect that we will need to consider. The third aspect is in terms of the criticality of that category to the organization itself. How critical is it? Does it have an impact from an external market-facing impact perspective? Does it have an impact from a quality perspective, or does it have an impact from a safety perspective? These three parameters will need to be considered while defining whether this category needs to be managed at a global level, or can it be, or should it be done at a more at a regional level.
Oops, perfect. Sorry about that. I was having trouble getting to my little mute button. Next question, and thank you for that explanation. That was great. The next one reads, what tips can you suggest where the internal stakeholders are resistant to building a relationship with procurement? Good question.
Yep. Again, a great question. And I think that touches a bit upon the change management challenges that I had talked about a bit earlier. Gotcha. I think one of the things that we need to remember here is that category strategies is never developed in isolation. It's never an output from procurement function alone. Category strategies needs to be defined or developed in consolidation with support from the functions that are going to be impacted. That's a critical part, which will also help in managing the change. When the functions or the businesses are involved in defining the category strategies, there is more ownership and more accountability in terms of making sure that that strategy succeeds. The second part of it is communication of the category strategy. That needs to be articulated in the appropriate way, depending on who the audience is. If it is finance, the focus might be from a cost perspective, but if it is business perspective, you need to understand and articulate what is in it for them. What are the kind of value that they can expect, whether it is in terms of better service, more convenience, simplicity, etc. Those are the factors that needs to be emphasized while communicating the change to the necessary audience. Third part is to look at or ensure that there is compliance and monitoring the reasons for non-compliance. Some of the non-compliance could be driven by real issues or things that have changed since this strategy was being defined. Understanding that and ensuring that that's been addressed and factored into the core strategy, it will be a critical part. So that's how we can drive more change.
That's great. Thank you. Let's see. We are getting close to the end of the hour. A couple minutes left. I'm going to squeeze in one more question, and that is, how is a category strategy different from a sourcing strategy?
Great question. I think that's a fitting question to be the last question. So the main difference is category strategy is, more importantly, a strategic activity which would be focused on the business outcome that needs to be achieved. So category strategy, as we saw from the examples below, is not just about selection of the suppliers or structuring the contracts. It's about the way the category itself will be structured to provide the necessary support for achieving a business outcome. So whether it means using an external agency or doing it internally, what kind of technology needs to be leveraged to support that, and what kind of structure of supply partnership do we need to put in place, whether we are going to go with a global partner or are we going to go with a regional structure. Those are the kind of decisions that are done in the category strategy. Sourcing strategy, on the other hand, is all about selection of the right suppliers, the approach that is there for selecting or driving the best value from those suppliers, and the strategy that needs to be put in place to define the best contract to drive the kind of behavior that you would expect from the partners, internal levels as well as external. So sourcing strategy would be a function of the category strategy, in other words.
Fantastic. And that does bring us just about to the top of the hour. I want to thank you so much for being here today. You really shared an extremely content-rich webinar with us today. And I want to remind everybody that we are pushing the file transfer out to you currently. You can, of course, also reference this for future reference in the next couple of days at the GEP website. And I want to thank everybody for taking the time to spend this last hour with us. It's been fantastic, and we hope to see you next Tuesday, September 19th. Our next webinar will be brought to us by Denali, a WNS company, discussing the 4 C's of a successful spend management project. Anything in closing, Bijal? Really want to thank you for everything today. It's a really great hour.
Thank you, Kim.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to go ahead and close it up. Thank you once again for being here, and have a really fantastic day.